Hello, my name is Osama Naga. This is the third part of the cardiovascular disorders. This short presentation is an introduction to the congenital heart defects. My objective in this presentation is to discuss the clinical approach to a child with suspected congenital heart diseases and a general approach to a child with or newborn with left to right shunts, cyanotic heart defects, left-sided obstructive heart disease, common chest X-ray and ECG findings in congenital heart defects, common associations with congenital heart defects or diseases. At the end, we'll give a summary to the presentation. So the first section is the clinical approach to a child with suspected congenital heart disease. History is critical in the diagnosis of any medical condition, like in this case, timing of presentation. Cases of severe coarctation of aorta usually presents with congestive heart failure in the first week of life. Cases of significant left to right shunt usually presents with congestive heart failure at 6 to 8 weeks of age. Gestational history is important. If the mother is diabetic, like maternal diabetes, commonly associated with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, but if the mother received medication during a pregnancy, like lithium, can be associated with Epstein's anomaly. Family history of congenital heart diseases. Physical examination starting from the vital signs like pulse and the blood pressure in the upper and the lower extremities. Cardiac examination including the inspection, palpation and auscultation. Listen to the first and second heart sound, if the second heart sound, single second heart sound, wide split second heart sound. Listen for murmur, the intensity and the grade of the murmur. Respiratory examination. Do not assume that all children with cyanosis, they have congenital heart disease. Pulmonary causes more common, like in cases of tension pneumothorax, can present with cyanosis. Look for absent lung sound in one side and shift of the mediastinum to the opposite side. After taking the history physical examination, this will help you to choose the best investigation, the best next step for this newborn or this child. Not all newborns with murmurs have congenital heart defect. For example, murmur in the first few hours after birth of closing ductus. This is normal, this is benign. Not all newborns with congenital heart defect have murmurs. For example, cases of VSD or AV canal defect, they may not have murmur after birth. And as the pulmonary vascular resistance drop and shunt from the left to the right increase, you will be able to hear the murmur afterward. Not all newborns with clinical findings of congenital heart disease need immediate intervention. For example, cases of ASD or atrial septal defect usually repaired in the beginning of school age. Know that it is often difficult to differentiate congenital heart disease from pulmonary and other diseases, especially sepsis, in a newborn infant. For example, cases of severe coarctation of aorta, hypoplastic left heart, can be confused with other cases of sepsis and shock. Clinical finding and red flags suggesting the possibility of serious congenital heart defect in a newborn. Metabolic acidosis unexplained, respiratory distress, poor peripheral perfusion, decreased pulses, difference in pulses like arm versus leg, like in cases of coarctation of aorta, single second heart sound, like in cases of transposition of great arteries, abnormally loud second heart sound, prominent heart murmur, abnormally prominent pulses, hyperactive precordium, and shock. In these cases, you need to obtain cardiology consult as soon as the diagnosis of congenital heart disease is suspected. Acyanotic congenital heart defects, VSD is the most common ventricular septal defect, PDA, patent ductus arteriosus, ASD, atrial septal defect, AV canal. Common association with AV canal is trisomy 21. The clinical presentation depending on the type of the lesion, severity, a degree of shunt from the left to the right. This case is also associated with increase in pulmonary vascularity on X-ray. And as the left to the right shunt increase, if the degree is more than 2 to 1, this can present with congestive heart failure. The timing of presentation usually between 4 to 6 weeks of age. If left untreated, this can cause pulmonary hypertension and irreversible increased pulmonary vascular resistance, which is well known as Eisenmenger syndrome. it is very important to know the X-ray finding in cases of congenital heart defects with left to right shunt increased pulmonary vascularity. For example, this case you will see here is a cardiomegaly with increased pulmonary vascularity. This is suggestive of a case of left to right shunt, congenital heart defect with left to right shunt. Characteristics of left to right shunt of congenital heart defects may present with murmur or no murmur at birth, increased pulmonary vascularity or vascular marking or blood flow on a chest X-ray. If symptoms develop, usually at 4 to 6 weeks of age because of decrease in pulmonary vascular resistance and increase in left to right shunt. If you give oxygen to an infant with congestive heart failure and the oxygen make their symptom worse, suspect a congenital heart defect with left to right shunt because oxygen decreases the pulmonary vascular resistance more, and this will increase the left to right shunt and worsen the congestive heart failure. Larger defects present earlier and more severe. If left untreated, this will cause Eisenmenger syndrome. Eisenmenger syndrome develops early in cases of AV canal and takes years to develop in cases of atrial septal defect. Newborns with trisomy 21, we need to know that echocardiography should be performed on all infants suspected of having trisomy 21, to identify congenital heart disease regardless if there is murmur or not. Very important to order an echo for all newborns with suspected trisomy 21. Cyanotic congenital heart defects here are classified according to the degree of pulmonary vascularity or vascular marking on the chest X-ray. It is associated with decreased pulmonary vascularity or decreased pulmonary blood flow on a chest X-ray. The differential is tetralogy follow, tricuspid valve anomalies, for example, tricuspid atresia, Ebstein's anomaly, pulmonary atresia, or Eisenmenger syndrome. If it's associated with increased pulmonary vascularity on a chest X-ray, the differential is simple transposition of great arteries, total anomalous of pulmonary venous return or connection, truncus arteriosus. This is a chest radiograph of a neonate with severe cyanosis. Very important to look at here, there in chest X-ray, there is a cardiomegaly, but what is more important to look at, the lung fields are clear. There is a diminished pulmonary vascularity in both sides. This indicative of right to left shunt, this indicative of right-sided obstruction. The differential diagnosis, tricuspid atresia, severe cases of tetralogy follow, critical pulmonary stenosis and pulmonary atresia. Clinical approach to a newborn with cyanosis: to do hyperoxia test, to give 100% oxygen, then you do arterial blood gas. In cases of non-cardiac or cases of pulmonary or lung, the arterial oxygen tension will increase after giving 100% oxygen to be more than or equal 100 millimeter of mercury. So it will increase, it will change. But if the case is cardiac, will be no change and will remain below the 100 millimeter of mercury. This is cardiac, this is the cause of the cyanosis if no response to the oxygen. Emergent management of cyanotic congenital heart diseases: bridging therapy towards intervention or cardiac surgery, to give prostaglandin infusion in ductal dependent lesions, to maintain the PDA open until they reach the surgeon. The side effect we need to know about the prostaglandin apnea and flushing. The differential diagnosis of ductal dependent lesions, the tricuspid atresia, pulmonary atresia, and severe cases of tetralogy of Fallot. Indications for deletion screening of chromosome 22q11. This is very important to screen even with no classic presentation of DiGeorge syndrome. If you have any newborn presents with conotruncal heart anomalies like truncus arteriosus, tetralogy follow, interrupted aortic arch, pulmonary atresia with VCD, they have to be screened for chromosome 22q11 or DiGeorge deletion. The preferred test is array comparative genomic hybridization. This is the preferred test, or chromosomal microarray analysis. And the FISH test is widely available, but you need to know the limitation of FISH test. Smaller deletions may not be detectable. Very important, very high yield in the pediatric board examination. Congenital heart defects present with congestive heart failure or shock in the first week of life. If you have a newborn in the first week of life presents with congestive heart failure or shock, the classic presentation, poor perfusion, metabolic acidosis unexplained, hepatomegaly, tachypnea, or gallop. The differential diagnosis in this case, coarctation of aorta, usually severe form of coarctation, hypoplastic left heart, interrupted aortic arch. These lesions are ductal dependent lesions. Emergent management of obstructive left-sided congenital heart defects: to keep the ductus open, to open the ductus immediately by giving prostaglandin and emergency cardiology consult. In this section, we'll discuss the common chest X-ray findings in congenital heart defects. In pediatric chest X-ray, when we are looking at the heart silhouette normally occupies 50 to 55% of the width of the chest. And when we evaluate the heart, first thing we look at the size of the heart, if the heart is small, normal, or large. And we compare the widest point of the heart to the widest point of the chest. And if the cardiac thoracic ratio more than 55%, this is considered a cardiomegaly in pediatrics. The next step is to evaluate the contours of the heart. We look at the left border starting from the top down. The tub here starts with the nub of the aortic arch, followed by the pulmonary artery, then left atrial appendage and left ventricle. On the right side, it starts from the top down, the superior vena cava, ascending aorta, right atrial appendage and right atrium. Then the next step, we look at the vascularity of the lung. If the vascularity is normal, diminished or prominent. Cases, for example, of prominent vascularity and cardiomegaly, this is indicative of left to right shunt. This is a normal chest X-ray of 9 months old. We'll use it to summarize the cardiac pathology and the changes of cardiac silhouette. The first pathology here is aortic arch dilatation. You will be able to see the aortic arch dilatation as a prominent aortic nub. The example of that, aortic stenosis and post-stenotic dilatation. The next pathology is main pulmonary artery dilatation, and you will see it as a prominent pulmonary trunk and blood vessels, and the classic example of that is a congenital heart defect with a left to right shunt. The next pathology is left atrial enlargement. The first sign you recognize here on the left for the left atrial enlargement is convex left atrial appendage, or enlargement of the left atrial appendage instead of being concave. The next sign is widening of the carina. It will be more than 90 degree, and the double cardiac silhouette in this location, or double density sign. The example of the left atrial enlargement, congenital VSD, or acquired like cases of mitral stenosis. Right ventricular enlargement, the cardiac apex will be upward, will be uplifted upward, and in the cases of left ventricular enlargement, the apex will be downward displaced. And the cases of right atrial enlargement, you will see fullness of the right side. The classic example of that is Epstein's anomaly. Know that severe cardiomegaly in infants will be very hard to specify which chamber is enlarged. It can be very difficult, especially in infants. Congenital heart defects and associated changes in the cardiac chambers: ASD associated with right ventricular enlargement, right atrial enlargement, and pulmonary artery dilatation. Tetralogy fellow associated with right ventricular enlargement, hypoplasia of pulmonary arteries, and Coransebo or bow shaped heart. Truncus arteriosus, right ventricular enlargement, pulmonary artery hypoplasia. PDA associated with left ventricular enlargement, left atrial enlargement, pulmonary artery dilatation. VSD associated with left ventricular enlargement, left atrial enlargement, pulmonary artery dilatation. Coarctation of aorta, left ventricular enlargement, and notching of the inferior surface of the ribs. Aortic stenosis, left ventricular enlargement. This is a 2 months old, presents with acute respiratory distress. In this X-ray, if you look at the cardiac size, if you measure the widest point of the heart and compare it to the widest point of the chest, the cardiothoracic ratio is more than 55%. The next step is to look at the pulmonary vascularity. The pulmonary vascular markings here are prominent in both sides. There is increased blood flow on both sides. So if you look at the age, this is a 2 months old, presents with acute respiratory distress. There is a cardiomegaly, diffuse cardiomegaly, with prominent blood vessels in both sides. this is an indicative of a congenital heart defect with left to right shunt. The differential diagnosis is VSD, ASD, or PDA. This is a chest x-ray of 10 years old boy with history of cyanotic spills. If you look at the chest x-ray here, there is a narrow mediastinum because of hypoplasia of pulmonary valve. And if you look at the apex of the heart, it is displaced laterally and upward lifting. So displaced laterally and upward lifting of the cardiac apex, this is indicative of right ventricular enlargement. If you associate that with decreased pulmonary blood flow and decreased pulmonary vascular markings in both sides, this is a classic of a tetralogy fellow. So narrow mediastinum, upward or uplifted apex of the heart, right ventricular enlargement, classic shape of Coran sabot or boat-shaped heart. This is a tetralogy fellow and with cyanotic spills. This is classic. This is important to remember. This is a 20 hours old newborn with cyanosis, not responding to 100% oxygen. Physical examination is significant for single and loud second heart sound with no murmur. If you look at the x-ray here, the mediastinum is narrow mediastinum. It's because the pulmonary artery here is not located here, is behind the aorta. And also, if you look at the pulmonary vascular markings are prominent in both sides. So this is a classic presentation of a transposition of great arteries. The classic view here is showing egg on a string. Egg on a string is string because of the narrow mediastinum. So if you see cyanosis in the first few hours, increased pulmonary vascular marking, narrow mediastinum, this is a transposition of great arteries. You confirm that with 100% oxygen. If it's not responding, no change in the oxygen, in the arterial oxygen, this is cardiac, this is emergency and requires immediate prostaglandin and emergency cardiology consult. This is a chest x-ray of a newborn presents with a cyanosis. If you look at the cardiac size here, there is a severe cardiomegaly filling all the chest. And if you see the remaining part here, the lung fields are clear. So there is a decreased or diminished pulmonary vascularity on both sides. This is a classic presentation of Epstein's anomaly. Usually there is a right obstruction in the heart because of malformation and defect in the tricuspid valve. And depending on the degree of the regurgitation, the right atrium will keep enlarging because of stagnation of the blood in the right atrium. So this is classic. This is very important to keep in differential. This is a 4 years old with failure to thrive dyspnea, recurrent pulmonary infections. The mediastinum here is a wide mediastinum, giving the characteristic snowman appearance. This is a classic x-ray of total anomalous of pulmonary venous return. Because of the wide mediastinum in the top here, because of the extra cardiac shunt, the pulmonary veins, they supposed to drain to the left atrium, they are draining to the right side of the heart through the extra cardiac shunt, left vertical vein in this side, through the innominate vein down to the superior vena cava in this side, making the mediastinum very wide, giving the snowman appearance. This is a classic chest x-ray of total anomalous of pulmonary venous return supracardiac type. In this section, we'll discuss common ECG findings in congenital heart defects. Common ECG findings in congenital heart defects. If you see large R in V1 and deep S in V6, this is indicative of right ventricular hypertrophy. Of course, you have to consider the upper normal limit of normal for age. If you see also a positive T wave in V1 in more than 1 week old, this is suggestive of right ventricular hypertrophy. The example is tetralogy fallot, ASD, persistent pulmonary hypertension of newborn. If you see deep S in V1 and large R in V6, this is indicative of left ventricular hypertrophy. The classic example is VSD, coarctation of aorta. For more information, more examples, watch the video of ECG. Superior axis is a high yield and is very important. It is negative QRS in AVF, negative QRS in AVF, which is simply left axis deviation. This can be associated with endocardial cushions, ostium primum type ASD or atrial septal defect, tricuspid atresia. Epstein's anomaly can be associated with right bundle branch block, which is wide QRS complex and R wave in V1. And classically, you may see rabbit's ears. WBW, which is Wolf Parkinson White syndrome. You will know that by noticing the short PR interval in the ECG and white QRS complex and delta wave, and we'll see that in the next few slides. Again, to emphasize, right bundle branch block is important to know, commonly seen after intracardiac surgery in pediatrics, and also can be associated with Ebstein's anomaly and ostium primum type ESD or atrial septal defect. The way to know it is by noticing the wide QRS complex RSR pattern in V1, wide QRS complex in V1 and RSR pattern or R wave in V1. Classically, you may see the rabbit's ears. This is an ECG for 16 years old with tetralogy fallot paired in infancy. If you look at the QRS complex in V1, it is a wide complex. So there is a wide QRS complex in V1 and there is RSR pattern. So there is R wave and wide QRS complex in V1. This is a right bundle branch block. And if you look also at the S wave in V6, it is wide. So again, right bundle branch block is wide QRS complex in V1 and there is RSR pattern here. This is a right bundle branch block. This is an ECG of 8 years old boy with palpitation. First step is to look at the rhythm. The rhythm here is regular. Then the next step is rate. 2.5 large squares, so 300 divided by 2.5 equal 120. Another method, we have 20 Rs here, so 20 times 6 equal 120. Then the next step is to look at the axis. We have here the AVF is negative and is positive in lead one. This is left axis deviation. Then after that, we'll look at the P wave and the PR interval. The P wave here looks normal, but the PR interval is very short. If we magnify it here, the PR interval is very short. And if we look at the QRS complex, is a wide complex. Then also we have here a slurring of the initial upstroke of the R wave. This is delta wave. So this patient meets the criteria of the diagnosis of Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome tachycardia with pre-excitation or short PR interval with wide complex and slurring of the initial upstroke of the R wave or delta wave. This is a review case. Newborn presents with cyanosis few hours after birth. Physical examination is significant for single and loud second heart sound, not responding to 100% oxygen. What is the most likely cause? The x-ray here, you will see narrow mediastinum, absent pulmonary trunk, you cannot see it here, and increased pulmonary vascular markings in both sides. What is the most likely cause? This is a classic presentation of transposition of great arteries. We started with the history, physical examination, oxygen test, chest x-ray. No echo was mentioned in this steps. Echo is not considered an emergency tool in the newborn nursery. So when you, from the history, physical examination, and the chest x-ray, if you suspect a transposition of great arteries, the next step is to give prostaglandin. Echocardiogram will be afterward for surgical planning and also the cardiology consult. Chest x-ray is a very important step in early diagnosis of cardiac conditions. Know that echocardiogram may not be readily available. So cases of cyanosis with decreased pulmonary vascularity, the differential diagnosis, tetralogy, fallot, tricuspid atresia, and pulmonary atresia. Cyanosis with increased pulmonary vascularity, transposition of great arteries, truncus arteriosus, and total anomalous of pulmonary venous connection or return. Congenital heart disease may present with respiratory distress and cyanosis is a total anomalous of pulmonary venous return, infradiaphragmatic type or obstructive type. This is considered a surgical emergency. This can be mistaken or always mistaken with respiratory distress syndrome or group B strep pneumonia. This is an x-ray for a newborn. It presents with respiratory distress, severe respiratory distress and cyanosis. As you see here in the pulmonary fields, there is an increase in pulmonary vascular markings in both sides. Severe pulmonary congestion can be mistaken with respiratory distress syndrome or group B strep pneumonia. And as you see here also, there is a cardiomegaly, mild cardiomegaly and uplift of the cardiac apex. So very important to keep in differential infracardiac total anomalous of pulmonary venous return when you have a newborn infant present shortly after birth with severe respiratory distress and cyanosis. Why? Because this is considered a surgical emergency. Without surgery, this infant will not survive. Very important, if you have congestive heart failure in the first week of life, consider a left-sided obstructive heart defects like coarctation of aorta, hypoplastic left heart, interrupted aortic arch. Remember, for these obstructive type cases, you need to give prostaglandin to open the ductus and the immediate cardiac consult. Congestive heart failure at 6 to 8 weeks is most likely left to right shunt. Congestive heart failure in older children acquired causes like myocarditis or rheumatic heart disease. Common syndromes associated with congenital heart defects. This is high yield. You have to remember these associations. Trisomy 21 commonly associated with AV canal or VSD. You have to do an echocardiogram for all newborn with trisomy 21, even with no murmur. Turner syndrome bicuspid aortic valve is the most common, followed by coarctation of aorta. Very important Turner syndrome. They have to have cardiology follow up for life because of high risk of aortic dissection. Trisomy 13 and 18 commonly associated with VSD. Kredisha commonly associated with VSD or ventricular septal defect. Noonan syndrome, similar to Turner but in boys, commonly associated with pulmonary stenosis. Marfan syndrome, common association is aortic dissection. Williams syndrome is intellectual disability, specific personality, idiopathic hypercalcemia. This can be associated with peripheral pulmonary stenosis and supravalvar aortic stenosis. Holt-Oram syndrome is a skeletal abnormalities of hands and arm, commonly associated with atrial septal defect or VSD. Lithium, commonly used for treatment of bipolar personality disorder, and this can be associated with Epstein's anomaly if it's taken during a pregnancy. Alcohol, ESD and VSD, retinoic acid, transposition of great arteries. Maternal diabetes can be associated with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, transposition of great arteries. Maternal lupus can be associated with congenital heart block. This is the end of this introduction. Thank you. This video is only for educational purpose and not intended to direct the care of any specific patient. Please consult your physician or the physician of your child for the correct diagnosis and the proper treatment. None of my videos can be superior or an alternative for the opinion of an experienced and licensed healthcare professional. Thank you again.